Hello everyone, my name is Iretiola and it gives me great joy to welcome you to another edition of my show. Now, if you ask some people, they will tell you that when it comes to Nollywood, there are far greater number of proficient women as opposed to men. Now, whether or not this is true is debatable. What is not debatable, however, is the fact that the two men that we are profiling today can be considered two of not just Nigeria, but Africa's leading men. Not only are they proficient at their craft, they are just so awesome to look at. So grab yourself a drink, perhaps a snack, make yourself comfortable as we drive you slowly into another interesting edition of Oge. Welcome back. Now you settle in. Do you have that drink? Are you comfortable? It's time to dig in into today's edition of the show. Now, our first profile is on a young Nigerian male actor that needs little or no introduction. I'll let him speak for himself.
Together, and you moved in with your new family, a family you kept secret from her. Don't you just care how this is affecting her? Are you really that Carlos?
My name is Blossom Chukwujekwu. Blossom, H is not Chukwujekwu, so Chukwujekwu. I was born in Benin City, Edo State. It's a family of four. My parents are evangelists, pastors. Reason I'm a church boy. studied mass communication at Benson Nelson University. Family was good. We were just two, myself and my younger brother. My mom knew that once I was done with school, it was Lagos to act. My father asked me, okay, we have options. Where do you want to work? I'm like, I just want to act. I didn't know how I was going to do it. I had nobody in the industry. I knew nobody. I didn't have any clue, any idea. I just wanted to act. It was just a passion I needed to fulfill.
I'm sorry, I really do have a problem understanding that, sir. From what I heard, this person we are dealing with is ex-military and is capable of doing anything. So I really do not understand why we should all sit down here and do nothing.
Because this is bigger than you, Francis.
But not you, sir. Who is this guy? She says it's someone who holds a grudge, but I'm sure that's an even bigger lie. Okay, let's just say that is true.
The journey to this point has been very challenging, but very importantly, you must stay focused. You must first of all know what you want. I say it, and I'll say it again, that talent is actually very overrated. It can only get you so far. It is commitment to talent, you know, that actually opens the doors. You need to have a plan. It might not go, you know, exactly as planned. It necessarily wouldn't even go exactly as planned, but you need to have a plan and do not be desperate. Now, a lot of young people nowadays do not understand what the waiting period does for every single one of us. The waiting period is a building process. It's a building period. It's a period where you actually find yourself. I think that's the most important thing. You find yourself and stay there. And how do you do that? You help yourself with people, with your family, people that will always keep you grounded. That's very, very key. Because entertainment, for example, is a jungle. And it can easily take you like this without you even knowing it. I worked really, really, really hard. I never really let the next man work harder than I worked. That's not to say I compared myself with anybody, because I feel like there is no competition. And I say that with no sense of pride. I just say it with every sense of humility and focus, because I just want to be better than who I was yesterday. You know, so it's very important to follow the process through, no matter how painful, feel the pain, no matter how daunting, no matter how challenging, face it. You know, do not try to jump. Do not think anybody is God, anybody has your destiny in their hands. Do not sell your soul. Just make sure you commit yourself to God and let Him lead you through. And that's what I did. And it's very important to always, always, always improve on yourself, improve on your craft. Now, because I necessarily wasn't desperate at, you know, desperate to make it, desperate to hit the limelight, desperate to be famous, I took my time to make sure that I try as much as I can to the best of my ability, hone my craft, you know, to what it is today. And I think that is something that a lot of young people need to understand. It's important to, even if you necessarily cannot afford the type of training that you want. I mean, there's Google, there's the internet, for God's sake. There's all types of information there. Just make sure you stay committed to that talent that you say you want.
And Obi, does she deserve this? How she found out about all of this? The lies, the secrets, the constant insults on social media, in public. How you moved into this place. The place you both were planning to live together, and you moved in with your new family, a family you kept secret from her. Don't you just care how this is affecting her? Are you really that Carlos?
First of all, I'll give that glory to God. You know, it's important that I always remind myself that I'm really not the most talented. I'm really not the hardest worker. There are people who work really hard. But it's also key to have it at the back of your mind that consistency is actually what keeps you relevant. You have to stay consistent. Now, I said, I always want to be better. For every finish line, there's a new race, right? So I make it a duty to stay hungry. I'm never satisfied. It doesn't matter the accolades I get. It doesn't matter how good anybody thinks it is. I just feel there is more. And I have never liked anything I did. And I'm not trying to be proud about it. That's just who I am. You need to see me during premieres. I'm cringing. I'm like, ah, what was I thinking? You know, that's how I am. I just want to be more, because the day you think you have arrived, the day you think, oh yeah, you're there, that's the day you die. That's the day your relevance ends. That's the day you stop growing. You know, that's the day you stop achieving. And also, I feel like I have a responsibility to deliver excellence in every single thing I do, no matter how small, no matter how trivial anybody might think it is. It's a weight of responsibility that I think about every single time. So that basically helps me give my best. You know, I think my desire for the spectacular actually just helps me put excellence in the work. Winning the AMVCA was a lot of responsibility. It was good to have been recognized. But even a lot more than that, I felt like, oh yeah, well, you're recognized, so what next? That after that night, right, what next? You need to actually supposedly defend why you had this. You know, why you won that. So you just had to, I had to work harder. That's what it did for me. I really just had to work harder to make people understand that, hey, well, it wasn't a fluke. And thank God, here we are. I'll be a lot of things. I think I will be some. I've been now, bros, in Upper Ibe Road, selling, you know, if I'm not selling spare parts, I'll be selling, you know, probably be selling DVDs or something. Yeah, seriously, I'll be a typical businessman. Or maybe a football manager. Yeah, but I think that whatever it is I found myself to do, I'll just excel in it, because I'll put every single thing, everything I had in it. So it's important that you understand that You must give your all wherever you find yourself. Attitude is important in life, and whether you're a cleaner, whether you're a barber, whatever it is you are, just be faithful in that gift and watch God magnify it.
What do you see in him anyway? Tell me, what? Tell me, aside the title, what do you see?
Francis, stop!
What do you see? Stop it! What's the big deal? Is he a better kisser?
I'm warning you, Francis.
That would be unfair because you haven't let me kiss you yet. Or does he touch you in the right places?
If I could do one thing to fix Nigeria, I would fix the mind of the young people. I would never leave God. Style is simply the way you do what you do. Three things that can impede one's journey to success: laziness, pride, desperation. Okay, my personal philosophy of life is simple. God over everything. It's simply whatever he says, whatever his word says, I try as much as possible to follow.
Now, our second profile is on another Nollywood player. Tall, dark, just as handsome, depending on what your spec is. But what is not in doubt is his proficiency at his craft. And just like Blossom, he needs very little or no introduction himself. I'll let him do all the talking. Enjoy.
My name is Deyemi Okanlawon, and I'm an actor. People tend to push you in line of sciences when you do well in school. So my father was an engineer. My mother's a more creative person. She bakes cakes and she makes really lovely cakes. And so I went in that direction of engineering, eventually got into University of Lagos, studied engineering, chemical engineering, and I graduated, but just went straight into my mother's company. My first job was as a sales manager, and because I had been selling her cakes and bread back in school, I literally did the same thing in about five other universities. And, you know, I was happy doing that. However, even from primary school, I was always actively involved in drama. I was part of every school play, as far back as I can remember. And I kept that going throughout my life. So even when I was working sales and marketing, I changed jobs quite a few times. Left my mom, started a business, worked somewhere else, I had another business. Eventually, I was the head of marketing for an e-commerce, one of the top five e-commerce companies in Nigeria. And all through this time, I was involved in a drama group in church. One day in 2010, I was talking to a client who mentioned that he had friends wanted to shoot a movie. And I'd always done stage in church. And wanted to shoot a movie. I said, okay, I could be interested. And he tells me, you know, gives me the details, and I go for the audition, and I get the role. And apparently there's some people in the, well, in the group or on the panel who saw me, and they also wanted to shoot a film, a short film. And they invited me to be a part of the short film. So my very first film was actually the short film called A Grain of Wheat. Somewhere on YouTube, on my channel. And then I did the feature film called ZR7, or The Red House 7. And I really, really had a good time doing those. I think I would pin it down to a few things. First of all, it almost feels like my entire life prepared me for this moment. The skills and, you know, the experience that I had, the skills and the experience that I garnered over the years sort of came into place. I studied chemical engineering, so my ability to analyze things, you know, was a bit different. I could sit down with a script, for example, and get more out of it than I think than average. I also think that my experience in sales, I was literally a door-to-door salesman, and I learned how to handle rejection very easily, very, very well. So auditioning was not an issue for me. So I was never really, I didn't come in afraid of anything. I was, you know, so I think all that sort of helped. I wouldn't be honest if I said I didn't have any doubt or any fears. But I'm a huge risk taker. I always have been since I was a child. I was one of those children where you say, don't do this, you can be sure that's exactly what I'm going to do. I think my mother even learned, if she wanted me to get me to do something, she tells me to do the opposite thing. And yeah, so I found out very late in life that that was what she was doing, by the way. Thank you, Mommy. but I've always been a huge risk taker. So irregardless of the fear and the doubts, I still went ahead and I said, this being what I'm passionate about, you know, let me give it a shot. There's a movie called Gone in 60 Seconds I saw years ago. And there's this black actor who played the detective. I forget his name right now. The essential thing is, this guy was ugly. And up until that moment, I had thought every actor needed to be handsome, you know, and be a pretty face. And then I looked at this guy who made acting so real, and his looks had nothing to do with it. And for me, one of the things that I would have found challenging was the fact that I didn't think I was good looking enough to be on TV. You know, so seeing him sort of freed me up to say, okay, if this guy can do it, I find a person small now. You know, that I could maybe do this. So one of the insecurities would be, you know, how you look. You hear things like, we want to have eye candy in our films, you know. You hear things like that, we want to go with a fairer skinned person, or if you do not have the six pack, you know, and that's all pressure. That's all pressure. I think men are able to pretend as if the pressure doesn't exist, maybe a bit more, but it's there. It's a really seductive industry. So being young and married, well, it's been very interesting. I personally don't talk about my marriage in public. Not that I have anything to hide or, you know, shy away from. It's just I'm able to compartmentalize. There's Deyemi, the actor, the public figure, the screen hunk, if you will. Thank you very much. And there's Deyemi Okanlawon, the family man and brother, son, you know, and I would get my head knocked real hard if I tried to mix the two and be a diva at home. It wouldn't happen. So navigating that, it's just really about switching it on and off. I know how I am or who I am when I'm outside, when I'm in front of the camera. And that's totally different from when I'm at home and I have responsibilities and I'm washing the dishes and I have my own chores to do. And I'm not expecting any thank yous or anybody gushing over me at home. But I need it, baby, I need it. A lot of people seem to think women have it more challenging and that there are only so many roles, you know, and such a huge number of female actors. But for men, we also face the same kind of competition because there's always some new person coming in who's, you know, bringing something new, some new talent, and we always constantly have to be on top of our game. And if you look at it really critically, I think only a few per time, only a few guys would really be out there. So yes, the competition is real. It's the same thing. I am a firm believer that as human beings, we can be anything that we want to be. We can accomplish anything that we want to accomplish. And so if another challenge comes my way and it's something that I'm really, really strong about, I would pursue it. I will pursue it. And I'm too many things to be only, you know, to be boxed up into one. The first thing I would say is that whether you're Christian or, you know, any other religion or any other belief or faith, I think that, you know, we should have that spiritual centeredness that builds confidence. The second thing would be always have a plan, have a meticulous plan. Now, as all plans, you know, go, they wouldn't exactly, you know, pan out the way you expect, but always have a plan. And at the end of that, make sure you execute on your plan. There's something about the power of intent, whatever it is that you actually move towards, suddenly starts to come towards you in return. So things start to happen. So that's it. Everyone should spend some time, you know, reflecting, self-reflection, and that's what I mean by prayer. And also, you know, plan things. Have a backup plan. You know, don't just jump into it. Okay, quick three fashion tips. Find somebody who's very fashionable, that has your body type, and copy. That always works. Be comfortable in what you're wearing. Think once you're comfortable and you're confident. I always say that, well, for me, I make the clothes look good. You know, I think the third thing would be, you know, be a bit daring. You know, sometimes you just add something nobody would expect. Style is who you really are. My biggest flaw is that I sometimes get too engrossed in my plans and in executing them. So, tunnel vision. One would be fear, self-doubt, and lack of preparation. I had a lot of training in that, you know. Being a very ugly child, girls always put me down. So I've learned. I think I just pretend it's not me. I'm not the one who got rejected. They saw something from their perspective and they rejected it. I'm whole. Always add value. Must always be adding value.
Once again, we find ourselves at the end of another edition of our show. And I sincerely hope that you enjoyed yourself just as I enjoyed bringing it to you. Now, you know what to do. Send us an email, hit us up on social media, tell us what you think, what you'd like to see, and we will be more than happy to respond. Now, until I come your way with another exciting edition of this show, I'm asking you to look after yourselves and let's be kind to one another. Goodbye.